треба повелят.
Good afternoon. My name is Lumír Ondřej Hanuš. I am Czech, originally from Czechoslovakia, today from Czech Republic. And I started research on cannabis in 1970, so it means 43 years ago. And I was working at medical faculty of the Palackie University in Olomouc 20 years. And now I am working 24 years at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, where I was invited just for 1 year, but results were such good that they wanted me another year, and it happened that at the end I decided that I can earn pension over there when I was so many years. So I would like to tell you something about history, about compounds in cannabis, about what we treat in Israel, and how it came that cannabis as medicine is today such popular. You know, marijuana is most widely used illegal substance. It's about 250 million annual users, but only 14% of them are daily users, and only 10% of them became dependent. And these dependent, when they want to treat themselves, so sometime they have some abstinent syndromes, such strong that they return to continue smoke cannabis. But it's one of the safest drugs, and I think that if we compare cannabis as medicine with legal pills, so you can see that they are more safe. Cannabis is more safe, doesn't have side effects which can cripple a person like as legal medicine. Everybody, I am sure, knows in this hall that cannabis has male plants and female plants, and marijuana are female flowering tops, and hashish, this is resin which originates on these female flowering tops. Several years ago I had lecture in Siberia, in Tomsk, and I was surprised when we went by car on the road, so kilometers and kilometers on both sides was all the time cannabis. So if they want to do eradication over there, so probably impossible. But they have very good source for medicine because they can extract compounds. Maybe this is wild, so these are not such high concentrations of the active compounds, but still it can be very valuable as medicine. Probably the most ancient use of cannabis is probably in Czech Republic, in southern Moravia. There at archaeological excavations, they found impressions of fibers, and this studied Czech and US archaeologists. And found that they weave, as you can see, these two types. And probably it was cannabis, but maybe it was nettle. They were not sure because impressions were not such good. But if it was cannabis, what is possible? Because they found not on here, but elsewhere they found pollen, yes, so it can be the oldest use of cannabis about 25,000 years ago. But of course proof the use of cannabis is in China about 6,000 years ago. It was used as technical cannabis to produce fibers and use it in everyday life, but it was also used as medicine. you know, around 5,000 years ago in China was mythical emperor Shennung, and he's considered in China as father of agriculture, and he called hemp Chuma, what you can see below his picture, and he considered it like superior elixir of immortality, and this female hemp was used to treat malaria, gout, beriberi, constipation, rheumatism, absent-mindedness, and menstrual problems. About 2 years ago came to Jerusalem Chinese scientists and brought us hairs from the tombs which they found in desert, in stony desert. They found tombs where was everything preserved, and this was probably one tomb, was tomb of shaman. And they found vessels from leather and from wood, and they were full of leaves and seeds and shoots of cannabis. So if it was just near your skin, so it's acuteus. If it was at the end of the hairs, it's chronicleus. Unfortunately, we didn't find any compound from cannabis over there, so it's not clear why they use cannabis and why it was in the tomb of shaman, but it's sure that he used it in some ceremonies, or religious, or medicinal. Assyria, which ruled a huge part of Middle East for almost millennium, so preserved as their legacy on clay tablets, which were discovered, and they used different names for cannabis. Gurguru, it was, if they use it for ship's cables or ropes, because you know that cannabis is very good, because when it's wet, it doesn't spoil, and it stays preserved in good shape. So because of that, it's used for ropes for ships. And when they use it in religious rites, they call it kunubu. Azala, it was interesting. It was like, they call it hand of ghost in translation. Poison of all limbs. So probably they use it to treat some neurological diseases. And then ganzigunnu, it was like a rubber which screw away your soul, what probably today we can call cannabimimetic. It means how influence something by cannabis. In Egypt, also as you see almost 4,000 years ago, medicinal cannabis was called shamshim too, what means medical hemp. And it was written, they found so-called Ebers papyrus, which was written in demotic script. This is written from left to the right, hieroglyph just opposite. And in lines, what is, you can see this name, Shemshem II. In line 7-8, they found hemp ground in honey introduced into her vagina. And another part is that it used as remedy for toenail. So probably it was treatment of inflammations. In India, where everybody knows what are Vedas, so in Atharva Veda is mentioned again cannabis, like succulent grass, and there is written that preserve one from disease and prolong the years we have to live. So again, it's clear that it was signed like a plant which can cure you. Scythians is very interesting in Siberia, in Russia, in a place called Pazirik, were preserved tombs from 5th century of Scythians, what was ancient nomadic tribes, and Herodotus of Halicarnassus in his history preserved how they use it, that they had hot stones and they threw on these stones seeds and they covered themselves with blanket and they were influenced by these vapors and howl like wolves, as he wrote. According to my opinion, this was not these were not seeds which they threw on the hot stones, but what is pictured down, you can see that female flowering tops, when they have fruits, it means seeds, so they are full of seeds, so probably they threw this flowering tops with seeds, and they were influenced with tetrahydrocannabinol, which was inside. And if we go forward, so I cannot mention all civilizations which use it, but the main. In ancient Rome, Pliny the Elder used for treatment roots, which were boiled in water to ease cramps, joints, gout, to end similar violent pain. And in ancient Greece, Pedanius Dioscorides again used roots for about the same treatment. So it means that one of them knew about the other one, or it happens often in science that the same discovery is independently discovered on two different places. So maybe at the same time, both of them found that the roots of cannabis are useful. Interesting is to mention about before 1,800 years, Chinese physician Huatuo, which used cannabis for anesthesia. He called this medicine, which is unknown how it was exactly, he called it Maifesan, and it was made from wine and cannabis. So he did under anesthesia with this Maifesan laparotomy, what is serial surgery. So he's appreciated anywhere like for anesthesia. In Judea, what is in the fact it's city, Bet Shemesh, about 23 kilometers from Jerusalem, they found the grave of a young girl. She was pregnant, and probably because she was too young, so she couldn't give a birth to her child. So during that she died, and archaeologists found in her body gray material, which you can see on the picture. And they send it to our lab, and we found that this is cannabis. And we found over there delta-8 tetrahydrocannabinol. This is isomer of delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, which is used to make you high. Only it's isomer, which is very stable, and it's a little bit weaker. Still in Israel, you can find a lot of hashish, illegal hashish, of course, usually it's from Lebanon or from Morocco. And in Europe, it's rather unique when you can see hashish, because today are produced such strains of cannabis that marijuana is very strong and is better than hashish before. But in the Middle East, still hashish is used, and these are in such sex. It's big about like soul, really, and it's called also soul. And as you can see, there are very nice writings on that. At your service, the best is in your hands, like Aladdin's lamp. or you can see Baalbek terraces, large fortress. This we have from police, we usually from this hashish isolate not THC but cannabidiol. Or there is camel, because camel is symbol of patience, so patient without borders. So probably it means that they must be patient during smuggling. I would like to return again to China. There is a region which is called Bama, and there live minority Yao, and these are considered healthiest, longest lived people in the world. There is unbelievable statistic because residents of this district have a reputation of healthiest and long-lived inhabitants, and they are very interesting for geriatrians. Only 4 of 10,000 will give cancer. They are very healthy. But why they are healthy? Here is a village, picture of village where are very healthy these people, because they use as major food for over 2,000 years cannabis. Secret of their longevity are several. One of them is soup made from the oily seeds of the cannabis plant and snake wine, rice wine, which they drink all the day. And here how they make this soup. Of course, they clean cannabis seeds, then they boil it, and then they add some vegetables, and they eat it every day. And this is excellent food, and also it's perfect medicine, because I shall mention later what was treated in Olomouc, where I work at medical faculty, because all 20 years when I was in Czechoslovakia at medical faculty, so I prepared extract of cannabis for drugstore, and in medical hospital they use it all the time for the treatment. All 20 years from 1970 to 1990 when I was over there, but they of course use it also before. And then in China, it's very dangerous to have cannabis because there is death penalty, so without any mercy, they finish your life. So hemp, which is produced over there, it's industrial hemp, and they use it for many reasons, as you can see over there. But it doesn't matter if it's industrial or if it's a strong drug, because just they use seeds. So here is, they have highest frequency people over 90, over 100, over 110. And here is one lady who looks 107 years old. And here is my friend, Kaiten Yang, which is working over there with cannabis, with this lady, and Dr. Rosenfeld from the United States, which also have contact in China, because he won't produce cannabis medicine without intoxication, so it's concentrated on cannabidiol, what can be isolated very cheap in China. So here he is, this person, which is 115 years old. Main his food every day is cannabis. Here another one lady, 100 years old and still working. From what I was fascinating from this place, that even cannabis grows very old, because we know that it's annual plant, you must see it every year. These are cannabis trees which are about 25 years old. So it should be very interesting to do analysis to see what is that. In June I was in Jamaica. They invited me for lecture. And for my lecture came Rasta, which never cut their hairs. You know, it's something unbelievable. Some of them even had longer hairs than this Rasta. And then there were Tevahedo. This is just Christians. And they use just cannabis as sacrament. And it's even for them illegal, but they are fighting for, they are against legalization, but they are for decriminalization of cannabis. That simply, you cannot be punished by criminal law, only by civil law. Or it's better, and that it can be very easily used as medicine. So it was very interesting, because they took me also to the places where we were surprised, where they never took some foreigners, that we can see how they cultivate it. You know, I won't mention from start of serious research John Russell Reynolds. Already in 1859, he wrote in his publication, "For the relief of certain kind of pain, I believe there is no more useful medicine than cannabis within our reach." And then many years later, again, "Indian hemp, when pure and administered carefully, is one of the most valuable medicines we possess." So it was not clean, but from the year to the year, I shall talk about that. It's very interesting how powerful it is, medicine. Now I go to Czechoslovakia, because it was not in Czech Republic, it was in Czechoslovakia. Professor Zdeněk Krejčí, this was my head of department where I was teaching and doing research at medical faculty in Olomouc. So he studied higher plants for antibacterial activity, and he found that cannabis sativa is powerful antibacterial plant against gram-positive microorganisms and also some pathogenic microorganisms. And this was studied successfully clinically already in the 50s, so not like it was found in the United States in after 70s. Yes, so, and in 1955 they found which compound is responsible. They call it cannabidiolic acid, and this was the first acid which was found in cannabis. And after decarboxylation, after heating it, decarboxylate to cannabidiol, which you know that is today one of the two most important compounds in cannabis. Already in 1954, at our medical faculty in Olomouc in Czechoslovakia, was conference Konopí jako lék, means cannabis like medicine. So we can say that in Czech Republic it was a rebirth of medicinal cannabis, because from that time, all the time, it was used in hospital. Because it was known like antibacterial compound, so successfully they use it against herpes simplex. Herpes zoster, what was wonderful, pressure ulcers, bed sores, so they treated it perfectly with cannabis. So this was in the fact in start of medicinal cannabis rebirth that we didn't know too much about that, but for that time it was really wonderful, especially for the bed sores. Because this sometimes patient can feel bed sores even when it's 24 hours in the bed. Patients that it goes very fast, and it can go up to the bone, that you can see bone. So it was very good that they found that it can be treated with cannabis and that they can start directly when bed sores appeared. Concerning tetrahydrocannabinol, the active compound in cannabis. You know, I don't like too much to use word marijuana, because it doesn't sound good for many people. which are against that, so I like to use medicinal cannabis every time. Because it doesn't matter if it's, they call technical hemp, and they call marijuana, but it's not marijuana because it's hemp, and flowering tops are marijuana, not the plant, so it's incorrect. So we should talk about medicinal cannabis. So at 40s, Roger Adams in the United States, he tried to elucidate structure of tetrahydrocannabinol, and he published correct structure, only one double bond was incorrect. So he solved almost whole problem. And in 1964, Jechiel Gaoni a Rafael Meshulam at Weizmann Institute in Rehovot, they isolated tetrahydrocannabinol and found structure of this compound. But 1 year before, in 1963, Professor Shantavi at Medical Faculty Palackej University, where I was working, found correct structure and absolute configuration of this compound. But he's unknown because it was published in University Acta. Nobody read this Acta. So it's mentioned Professor Gaoni and Meshulam, and never is mentioned Professor Shantavi. But to know that two groups, simply at two different part of world at the same time, found the same. It happened many times. So this is the structure, Delta 9 tetrahydrocannabinol, which is probably the most popular compound in the hemp. If you read any publication, usually you can read that today are known 60 or 70 cannabinoids. These are typical compounds which are in cannabis and you cannot find them in any other plant. And that are about between 400 and 500 all identified compounds. It's not true. I studied it detailly and have all publications. So today is known 1,015 compounds in cannabis, and 125 from them are cannabinoids, what are typical compounds. So this correct, I won't publish it because all the time I cited publications which mention only half of that. These are the main compounds in cannabis. This is cannabidiol, tetrahydrocannabinol, and cannabinol. These are three important compounds. And then there are propyl derivatives. The side change, instead of five carbons, have only three carbons. There are some other compounds, but unfortunately, we don't know enough about other compounds concerning treatment. So to these three compounds, I mentioned another two, usually cannabigerol and cannabichromen, which are also efficient for treatment. But still, scientifically, we don't have enough material. How originate these compounds? Starting with cannabigerolic acid, because these compounds are in cannabis plant like precursor, it means acids. So you cannot see in fresh plant THC or CBD or CBN, but there are acids. And from starting is like cannabigerolic acid, and independently it goes to cannabidiolic acid and to delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinolic acid. And if you won't use it as medicine, you must decarboxylate it. It means you must heat it to decarboxylate these cannabinoidic acids to appropriate cannabinoids. Because sometimes people use for treatment, you know, if you use it by smoking or vaporization, or you prepare cakes with cannabis, it's no problem. It's decarboxylated instantly. But if you use it by cold way, maceration in oil or other types of medicine, which was not heated, so sometimes people don't know about that and they think, oh, I use it and it doesn't work. So somebody told me it's a very powerful strain. It must help you. But they don't know that they must decarboxylate it. Because of that, it doesn't work. So it's important to know. You know, when scientists knew what is the main active compound, so they wanted to know why it works in the body. You know, after 1964, when was elucidated structure of tetrahydrocannabinol, so still it was not such accepted like medicine, and only identification or discovery of cannabinoid receptors in the brain, what happened in 1988, Dr. William Devane from St. Louis University discovered in the brain cannabinoid receptors. For imagination, you can look on that like that a receptor is locked and THC is like key. So if you smoke cannabis, so THC like key enters this lock, cannabinoid receptors, and when it opens, so all what you can see, behavior of person, so it's a result of this interaction of this ligand, we call it ligand, ligand, anglicky ligand, and lock, what are receptors. So soon after discovery of this so-called central cannabinoid receptor, which is called today CB1, was discovered peripheral cannabinoid receptor, today is called CB2. And this is very important to know where are these cannabinoid receptors, maybe on the next slide, you know, they are in the brain, and as soon as were discovered the receptors, so started to be clean why it works in the body and why it influenced the body. Because scientists directly scanned brain and check where are high concentrations of these receptors. So they found in basal ganglia, so where is movement controlled, cerebellum, body movement coordination, and hippocampus, learning, memory, cerebral cortex, higher cognitive function, or nucleus accumbens, a reward center, you know, is very important. This is why it's smoked, just for fun. So it started to be clear which part of the brain are influenced and why under influence of cannabis you behave, how you behave. But scientists, okay, here to finish these receptors, so you see that these receptors like CB1 are mainly in the brain and then in the reproductive system. It's very important that the reproductive system is influenced by cannabinoids. And then CB2 receptors are in lymphoid organs and pancreas, macrophages in high concentration. Of course, you can find it, for instance, in the skin, in anywhere. Cannabinoid receptors are one of the most spread receptors in human body, and because it's almost in any part of the body, so this is also explanation why it can treat so many diseases. When already was clear how it works in the brain, so it was clear for scientists that cannabinoid receptors in the brain are not to wait when somebody smokes cannabis and that this cannabinoid binds to the cannabinoid receptors. So it was hint to identify adenogenous ligand, this key for the lock, which is in our body. And I was lucky that just in November 1989 for communism in Czech Republic, and I was 16 years in contact by letters, even when communists all the time suggested me not to correspond with Israel. I told them over all the time, no, this is scientific correspondence. It's no politic, of course. So it happens in November 89. In February 1990, Professor Meshulam invited me to Jerusalem, and in September 1990, I was already over there. I thought in the fact that I shall continue in cannabis research, and I was surprised when he told me, you know, you are analytical chemist. I invited molecular pharmacologist. This was Dr. William Devane, which discovered cannabinoid receptors. So you can be team, and you must try to isolate and identify in the brain natural ligand. He gave us 1 year. After 1 year, we knew a lot about it. We saw, because I was isolating, and Dr. Devane was, he had bioassay, he knew how to isolate receptors, so he checked all my fractions, if they are active for cannabinoid receptors. So we knew more and more. After 1 year, Professor Meshulam said, I think that we cannot succeed. This is probably wasting of money. So we start to force him to try with us another year. He said, okay. So and after half a year, I succeed to isolate this compound. Dr. Devane checked it. It was active, and it was for us really surprise that this compound was as active as tetrahydrocannabinol, that binds to cannabinoid receptors with almost the same activity. It was unbelievable. And these endocannabinoids, because they started to study them, and many physiological systems and conditions are affected by endocannabinoids. Here is partial list. And if you see appetite, blood pressure, cerebral blood flow, digestive system, emesis, nausea, immune system, inflammation, memory, mood, movement. So when I only read this, so you can think directly, oh, if somebody smoke joint, so this is exactly what is influenced. So it works the same as THC, but this is natural compound in the body. And if is some disbalance, person is sick, so body start to fight, and start to fight balance of these endocannabinoids. And sometime, if this disbalance continue, so we know today that we can use cannabis as medicine to reach this balance, to mean treat the patient. So this compound, which we identified, we called it anandamide. This is me with Dr. Devane, discoverer of cannabinoid receptors in the brain. And we call this compound anandamide. Ananda, it means in Sanskrit bliss, delight. And amide is amide because, as you can see, it's arachidonoyl ethanol amide. So ananda, it was like what we expected, that how it can behave. At the same time, this ananda, this happiness, bliss, this was like happiness of scientists that discovered this compound. And amide because this is ethanolamide. So it's endogenous compounds which plays role, is again clear, because if we compare with cannabis, pain, depression, appetite, memory, fertility. So in the fact, compounds from cannabis, they mimic endogenous compounds in our brain and in our organism, in also in other parts of our body. And it's unbelievable that structurally these compounds are very different. One is just from higher plane, one is from the brain, and they bind to the same place with about the same activity. So it was good luck. Later we isolated several another these endocannabinoids, but anandamide remained, even when I isolated more active compound, so anandamide remained like favorite, like first compound, so you can find mostly publications on anandamide. And these discoveries of cannabinoid receptors, of endocannabinoids, they help to explain why cannabis such works, and it really opened door because now it was proved scientifically that cannabis is medicine. Still with problems, but probably these are problems of pharmaceutical companies, because I can tell you that one lady in Czech Republic is she has multiple sclerosis, and her father wrote to Parliament that he cultivated for daughter because it helps her and so on. And one member of Parliament took specialist to check why it's like that, and he wrote them, you know, pharmaceutical. It was surprised that he sent me this letter. Pharmaceutical companies invested a lot of money to treat pain and cancer and this, and they want this money back. They are not interested in that is some cheap medicine, that they need in tower pills. So this is the main problem. At least over there it was proved officially. So here are some another endocannabinoids. This anandamide, homogamalinol, letanolamide, docosatetraenol, letanolamide, arachidonide, glycerol, nolidine ether. These we isolated in Hebrew University. And another two, virodamine and arachidonoyl dopamine, these were isolated in the United States. And if somebody asks very simply, what do endocannabinoids? So you can answer what mentioned Vincenzo Di Marzo, scientist from Italy. So he very nicely answered, relax, eat, sleep, forget, protect. Because you have relaxation from endocannabinoids, but the same is also for cannabinoids. Eat, appetizer, sleep, you sleep good. Forget, because like soldiers or from car accidents, when people are in stress, so some of them are sick. Yes, and this can help treat them because they forget these bad memories. And protect, because it's neuroprotection. What was proof? I tell you directly about that. So it's therapeutic target, this endogenous cannabinoid system. And as I told you, these memories, unpleasant, can be treated. So it was for the first time in the fact, more scientifically did it former soldiers, American, after Vietnam War. They had post-traumatic stress disorder, and because of that they used to smoke cannabis and they forgot these problems. So they said, these are drug abusers. But no, they treated themselves. Today, scientifically, yes, it's for treatment, post-traumatic stress disorder. But at that time, you know, in the United States, they look at that differently. So cannabis is a wonderful medicine, but on any lecture, I tell it's a wonderful medicine, but it's not panaceum. It's not miraculous medicine. So it doesn't cure every time. It doesn't cure everybody. It doesn't cure every disease, and it doesn't treat every stage of disease. So, but even when I tell you this for no, so it means that it's true, this for no, but mostly it treats, you know. successful, it's between 80-90% as palliative medicine. What is wonderful, and no drug can compete with cannabis. You know, I shall talk about risk, but don't think that it's dangerous for everybody. It's very small percentage, very small. It's probably less than percent. People which can be in risk concerning psychosis or schizophrenia, these are which has family anamnesis, that there were such diseases, or some labile persons which this disease is already dreaming in their body, so they can trigger it. But this is a really very small part of this. And risk is of course higher in children and adolescents. In Israel it's used by children as medicine very successfully. About 80% children they can treat. But it's not good, to tell you, for developing brain. It means if you use it before age, about 22 years, when it's fully developed brain already, so it can trigger some problem. But again, amount of these persons is minimal, and if you compare it with legal medicine, so it's like nothing, it's no problem. Because problem which can be at children and teenagers, it never was with just adults, even when they were heavy smokers, so never had such problems. So it's not an innocent compound. This you must take in consideration. It's a powerful drug, of course. But if you compare it with alcohol, with cigarettes, so it's a wonderful plant, because if was full legalization of cannabis and was prohibition of tobacco, so world will be much more healthier. It's 100%. About children, I told you, so when child is treated, so every time parents and physician must think that there is small danger, yes, but in Israel, I don't know any one example, they treated hundreds of children with cancer without any problem. And even children, they are more sensitive than adults, so it works on them very good. Yes, and that cannabis is less dangerous when you smoke it than tobacco, it's clear, you know, somebody can tell you you will have cancer. No, nothing like that. It's not dangerous. Of course, if you use it as medicine, better is vaporization, because it's milder, you know, for your body. So, because then you use for treatment only these compounds and not these pyrolytic products, which can be dangerous, which can be cancerogenous. But it doesn't matter if you will smoke cannabis or some other plant, you know, any plant can be. Or if you are doing fire, you like fire in the nature, and you sit around and you have smoke, so it's the same danger. It doesn't matter what is it. So they cannot talk about that, of course. So concerning, I think that one is contraindication, just to drive car under influence of cannabis, because you can be at stage like after a little bit drinking of alcohol. Yes, so it can be simply it's better not to drive when you use cannabis as medicine. We are talking about medicine, of course. But when patients used all the time the same level, the same amount of active compounds, so driving abilities were better than before using cannabis. So it means that it can improve driving, and even if they use long time, they could drive. But it's not recommended, of course, because when they change the level, they use all the time the same amount of cannabis, so after a certain time it's no problem. But when they change the amount, that goes up or down, so then again can be problem with driving. So not to drive when you're using cannabis as medicine. You know, about tetrahydrocannabinol, this is known to everybody, how it influences our body, how it's powerful medicine. Eric talked about his powerful oil when it has a high percentage of THC. So I would like to mention a little bit cannabidiol. This is like Schlager today, you know. And in Czechoslovakia, at 50s, they already knew that cannabidiol is very good medicine. So, and today they discovered that this is powerful drug, also cannabidiol. That is anti-psychotic drug. Here is structure of cannabidiol. Again, you must decarboxylate cannabis to feel influence of cannabidiol. So first, that is antipsychotic effect. You know, it was at volunteers. It was interesting from start. I cultivated 1974. In the fact, in Czechoslovakia, this 20 years, I cultivated huge amount. I had 100 kilograms of marijuana. Never stealed anybody, no one leave. Every time who passed, oh, what is this high weed? They didn't know even that it's cannabis. Anyway, they say, ah, you know what is cannabis fibers? I say, ah, cannabis fibers. So nobody stealed, no one leave. Probably if I do this research today, it cannot survive overnight. So in South Africa, they found that in psychiatric hospital, that there were patients, they had psychotic episodes like a higher percentage in other countries. So they found that there is special strain, that there is no cannabidiol. And accidentally I cultivated it in 1974, and we also found that there is no cannabidiol. So it's very interesting. So at that time, they decided to check how bodies influence without and with cannabidiol. So they took volunteers. These were healthy volunteers, and they gave them 0.5 milligram per kilogram of body THC. And then they gave them 0.5 milligram plus 1 milligram per kilogram CBD. So as you can see, red line, disconnected thought. This time, after 3 hours, it was up to 50% volunteers. When they had it with cannabidiol, nothing like that, zero. Perceptual disturbance. It came after 30 minutes or 40 minutes, up to 70%. With cannabidiol, tetrahydrocannabinol, they had no this problem. Important is that if you treat with that, it treats, only it, you doesn't have this psychic problems. Depersonalization, again, it came after 1 hour about to 50%, And viscanabidiol, it was later and lower, about 30%. And resistant to communication, what is common when you use cannabis? So it came up to 70% of volunteers after 3 hours, but if they use tetrahydrocannabinol with cannabidiol, no such problem. So it was proved that cannabidiol at certain diseases is very important, that not only THC, but that there must be certain amount also of CBD. Cannabidiol has many activities. I don't want to talk about because it's I have just lecture only about cannabidiol. But simply it influences body by different ways, as you can see, and this can be everything explained and used in many diseases. Cannabis is excellent for treatment of schizophrenic patients. It was already in 2006, Zuardi, I think it's from Brazil, if I'm correct. And this was mutual work with Professor Meshulam. So cannabidiol has many effects, like on central nervous system, it's anxiolytic, panicolytic, anti-aversive, anti-schizophrenic. Everything was proved scientifically that it works. And then it has on immune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis or type 1 diabetes, and reduce unwanted effects on central receptor, which are involved with THC, including loss of memory, because short memory, yes, it's not good, but if there is some cannabidiol, so it doesn't happen. Cannabidiol works very good with diabetes because it's decreased destruction of these large enhanced islets and beta cells, what is very important in connection with diabetes, because significantly lowers blood glucose level and increase insulin level, what was proved on some sendrets, and doesn't lead to obesity. I shall return directly to this diabetes with one case which was in Czech Republic. There were many, but so this is unfortunately old. I don't have a newer statistic, but I can tell you that in Israel is today were issued 15,000 permits to use medicinal cannabis. Of course, some patients they had it at terminal stage, so they are already dead. So we don't have 15,000 patients. But from start it was like for cancer treatment. Today the main, as you can see, is pain, then cancer, gastro problems, which are with intestine, you know, Crohn's disease and so on, post-traumatic stress disorder, what I was talking about, multiple sclerosis, very important. Multiple sclerosis, you know that people are simply paralyzed, that they are on wheelchairs, and they have many problems. I have one friend in Prague, he was on a wheelchair, and it caused him treatment of this multiple sclerosis, 18,000 euro a year, of course without any success. Because usually, you know, in hospitals, I don't know, up to, I don't want to tell you a percentage, but very high percent of patients, they die not from disease, but from treatment. So father told him, try marijuana. He just, after first puff, I thought, unbelievable, he get up from wheelchair. So he started to use it and became a healthy patient. Yes, he walked with stick. Not good, but he's walking. And I saw how he used it. Just one puff. He told me, Lumir, one puff, I walk 1.6 kilometer. Without this puff, I am in a wheelchair. So it's really very powerful. And there are some other, of course, problem connected with multiple sclerosis, which cannabis can treat. And then fibromyalgia, chemotherapy, and so on. And I would like to tell you how it's in Israel. Maybe it can be interesting for you. How is treatment? So if somebody wants to be treated with cannabis, so he must go to physician specialist. And he must be sick with disease which is allowed to be treated with cannabis. Because there are many diseases which can be treated, but it's only certain amount of diseases which they are 100% sure that it works. But they don't have enough scientific records, so even if it can help, so it's not allowed. So you go to physician specialist, and he suggests you as patient for cannabis treatment. So he sent permit to Ministry of Health, and they can give you permit to use cannabis. Then you go to grower. We have 8 growers in Israel. They grow, they won't centralize it today, but what I recorded everything, so they grew altogether about 260 strains, different varieties of cannabis with different amount of cannabinoids. So they can cover any disease. And what is good that this grower, he give training to the patient and give him cannabis, and patient pays to the grower 370 shekels, what can be from low pension, about 10% of low pension. Yes. This money has grower. These growers before, they had this money, so they cultivated cannabis several years free of charge. And it's not cheap. But they cultivated and gave it to the patients. And later, they have this profit. Ministry of Health, nobody has nothing. I analyze it for patients. I have nothing from that. I am just happy that I can help them. Because when I started to do it, and I do it a lot in the last years, so because of that I can do less research. But, you know, it makes something very pleasant feeling for you when you see that it helps to the patient. So only grower has money from that. And now maybe cannabis doesn't help. So grower can change amount of cannabis, grower can change strain of cannabis, and then can find exactly strain or variety which fits you and which treats you. So patients are very happy. So they are in contact with growers. So it's I think it's Israel has the best this medical system concerning cannabis around the world, and from many countries are coming to learn that. Today they won't centralize it, that it will be center, and all growers must give cannabis to the center, and then they give it like medicine in drugstore, and will be sativa strains. This will be day strains and indica strains. This is like night strains, which is used for day treatment, for night treatment, and will be soft, medium, forte. Three like intensities according to the amount of cannabinoids. So this will be mild, medium, forte for THC, sativa strains, indica strains, and then again these three sorts for amount of cannabidiol, sativa strains, indica strains, and then cannabis in oil, which they use under tongue. This will be also three. It's without already without sativa or indica. This will be only mild, medium, forte. And then CBD strain and high CBD strain. And then cakes. Again, three sorts. Cakes are, for instance, for children. I can show you directly. I have it. You see, here is from one company. They have just normal and forte cannabis in oil, what they use under tongue. And here they have cakes. This one cake is about 1 gram, and they can take only quarter. You know, you can, because every time it's better start with small amount and go up. Because in Israel, in the fact around the world, it's used only as palliative medicine officially. It means that that you are after treatment without symptoms, but your disease continues. But anytime, you feel like healthy, often. So it's wonderful for you, like for patients, it's wonderful for your family, it's wonderful for friends. Everybody is happier, so it's very, very important, yes? And then, if they gave it at terminal stage, and patient, it's too late, is going to die, so his way to the other world is much more pleasant. He's not dying crippled, but he's dying that he feels better. And even like that, it is very good and very important. And they use also creams. Also, this is cream normal and forte, because it's very good for your skin, of course. So this I told you, that is about 15,000 Israelians. Something, cannabinoids and diabetes. This I told you that it treats diabetes, and they found that it's really powerful cannabidiol. And I show you something from Czech Republic. In 2010 was one lady, she's I think 74 years old now. She has toes diabetic. And I wrote it here, 70-year-old polymorbid diabetic woman. So they start to give her cream to stop sepsis and start healing. And from December to May, it was half a year, and you can see this toe, that is okay. It's nothing, it was her right leg, which was better. Left leg, they didn't expect that it will go like that, so first picture they took with bad camera, so it's not such nice. So this was her heel. So physicians decided that must be amputation, because it was really very deep. So they treat her with ointment, and you can see after half a year how it looks. So, and they gave her also vaporization because she had depressions from that and so on. So these vaporizations probably, this was just to feel her okay. I wrote several days ago to this guy. His name is Dušan Dvořák. And this is Dušan Dvořák. In black is a physician. And in the middle is this lady. So he was, it's just, I have, he took pictures, today is 20, and he took picture 17, so 3 days ago. This is this lady. This is her leg, which was supposed to be amputated. This is this heel, you can see where was this hole. It's treated. He's not 100% healthy. She walks very slowly to help her, this walking supporter. And he told me he was over there and she walked 50 feet, you know, at home. So it's good. So she's using all the time this. I had more pictures, but it's enough. Yeah, here is this this leg, how looks this toe, which was very bad. So today it looks also very good. So it's powerful for patients, and he had more patients with diabetic food. So, but just one to show you. And this is this Dušan Dvořák. He's cultivating cannabis. He established Cannabis is Cure company, like to treat patients. And he's near his house cultivating cannabis. So this is fifth year when he cultivates it. And every time he writes to the police and to anybody that he's cultivating for research and treatment cannabis, and volunteers are coming only when it's ripe. You can see volunteers from this year, and they do him harvest free of charge. So he has many problems because of that, but he's doing it every year, and every year is telling them. And now he said, principal, even if I go to the jail, so I will do it because I won't do it for the patients. It's a little bit extreme. He goes with his head against the wall, but, you know, from one point of view, because of him, it was such spread, like medicine in Czech Republic. And in the beginning, I think it was in 2006, he invited me for several lectures, and Rick Simpson. He invited also Jack Herrer, but unfortunately 2 days before he was supposed to come, he had a heart attack and later he died. So I said, if it was 2 weeks before, so was also Jack Herrer over there. So, and which diseases are permitted to treat in Israel? This red, on experimental level. Oncological diseases, it's any type of cancer of any stage, chronic pain of different origin, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, Tourette syndrome, experimentally, glaucoma, Crohn's disease, colitis, and diseases of gastrointestinal tract, like Crohn, as I told you, muscular dystrophy, AIDS, hypertension, post-traumatic stress disorder, diabetes, serious sleep disorder, asthma, skin diseases, fibromyalgia, also experimentally. And they want only plant for smoking, oil, and cakes. But they tried everything, these growers, what could be good for patient. Dry flowering tops, extract of this dry flowering tops, extracted in oil, in vegetable oil, and cannabis butter. From this butter, after analysis, he knows how much to use, and he's preparing cakes. Cannabis tincture, cannabis honey, cannabis sugar, cannabis cream. I suggested them to prepare a suppository because it's in rectum is maybe 5 times better biodynamic than under tongue. But it's not like accepted at that region, Middle East, to use suppositories. Like, I don't know why. Okay. And medicinal cannabis is used for immunocompromised patients. So we did some study, now it will be published. because they use it just when they do transplantations, and as you can see, as you can read, so they have no side effects, and it's largely effective to treat patients, according to the professor Orr, which is doing this, about 80% patients are successfully treated with cannabis. Because it stimulates appetite, minimizes nausea, vomiting, and it's very important. Simply, it helps to treat the body of the patient. Neuroprotection. You know, today, there are young people are driving car very fast and are many accidents, and then are many injuries of the brain, what is very dangerous, and then physicians must treat that. So we studied at Hebrew University what is one of the endocannabinoids, what I told you, which was found in the brain, is 2-arachidonoyl glycerol 2-AG. So rat had one hemisphere injured, and we studied Aulux endocannabinoids, and we found that after 4 hours, 2-AG increased very much. This is this red from the green, yes. And it stayed still higher about for 24 hours. So it means that this endocannabinoid protects the body. What does it mean? When protects this endocannabinoid, if you use cannabis, so it can also protect this body, this example. And also we did such study that you can see control. On the left you can see this white place. This is infarct volume. And after 24 hours, when we add to the red more 2-AG, 5 milligram per kilogram, so you see that it significantly decreases this infarct volume. So it means that it's really works, that is very protective, neuroprotective. Appetite and feeding. It's also, we can prove it scientifically, because you know, everybody who is against, so we must prove it scientifically. Then they say, ah, yes, you was right. Now it's okay when it's proved scientifically. So we have small mouse, and was control, how they are developing. First, these were the first 8 days when they were born. So if you give them THC, so they grew up even better. When you gave them antagonist, it means this is compound which blocks cannabinoid receptors. So endocannabinoids cannot work in the body. So as you can see, after 6 days died 12 or 13, and after 7 days all pups of these mice died. But when they ate this antagonist which blocks at the same time also tetrahydrocannabinol, it's this yellow, so they develop okay. So it means this tetrahydrocannabinol protected it against this antagonist. Bone remodeling. Also, you know, old patients or after ovariectomy patients, they have problem with bones because they became fragile, or also old people. It's better in Greece because they use olive oil, so it works very positively. But we studied also other compounds, was found arachidonoyl serine and oleoyl serine, what are similar compounds to these endocannabinoids. And then after ovariectomy, these bones start to be fragile and there is less mass of the bones. So when they gave them this compound, endogenous arachidonoyl serine, so bones became better. So because in bones and in marrow, they found also that there are a lot of cannabinoid receptors. As I told you, these are one of the most spread receptors in human body. That is why it's treated like that. Now, Alzheimer's disease, which is just experimental treatment in Israel. You know, this is because of plaques in the brain, and Alzheimer's disease is really, it cripples person, that at certain stage you cannot communicate with this person. So in Israel is one kibbutz, Na'an, it's near Rehovot, and there are such patients, you cannot communicate with them. They of course cannot smoke cannabis or vaporize. So they decided to try if it will help them. So they ate like powder from the flowers, and they added to the yogurt which ate this patient. And what happened? Three patients started talk. Normally they could talk. One started not only talk but also write. And one patient felt so good that asked them if he can return home, that he feel healthy. You know, after small amounts of cannabis powder or powderized flowers they add to yogurt. So Alzheimer patients. So this they do in experimentally, but I think that it will be used also for treatment in the near future. Now, what they are using, because maybe you are interested in what are the sorts of cannabis in Israel, what they are using, that they are such successful in treatment. So they have high THC. You see that they have up 20% THC and very low cannabidiol. Then they have strains which is high cannabidiol, up to 26%, but you see it's mostly above 10%, or what they use, and very low THC. Another strains was high CBD and high THC. High, it means I considered what is more than 5%. Yes, so it's high CBD, high THC. And then, as you know, Sativex, it's an apartes 1:1, 50% THC, 50% CBD, and it's very expensive. They introduce it for treatment in Czech Republic. Pension is maybe low pension is 7,000 crowns or 9,000 crowns. Yes, no, 9,000 crowns I think is now pension, low pension in Czech Republic. And for months, these pills, this Sativex cost 14,000 crowns. And young, healthy people, which earn a lot of money, they needn't it. An old pensioner, how can buy it if it's 14,000 and he has only, or her has only 9,000 crowns? So we can see here that you can cultivate it. You needn't just buy it expensively from GW, from England. You see, from about 4% up to almost, I don't know, 14% anapartes. So all these concentrations. My friend, which I talk about him with multiple sclerosis in Prague. So in southern Moravia, is wild cannabis, Cannabis ruderalis. You can collect it in the nature. So he thought every time that he needs high THC cannabis. So one time he went to collect it in southern Moravia. He used this wild cannabis and it worked for his multiple sclerosis. He was very happy, wonderful. And as you can see, I compare it with cannabis for fibers, which were used in Czechoslovakia. In past, today is not cultivated for fibers, cannabis. So it's about the same amounts. Now only for interest, what are all spectra of compounds from many analyses in Israel? So THC was in cannabis flowers up to 36.7, but over 30, these were from these 516 samples, only 4. Usually it's between 10 and 20% mostly. As you can see here, I put it like spread according to concentrations. So you see mostly it's between 12 and 16%. 16 and 20 after that, and 8 and 12. So as I told you, between 10 and 20% mostly are these plants. And concerning cannabidiol, it's up to 24.7% CBD in flowers. And in plant oil, up to 53% THC per gram oil, up to 47% CBD per gram oil, they can do, or lower concentrations. Cannabis extracts, these were up to, because Rick Simpson, he can tell you, you must have as concentrated as possible THC. So vera extracts, vera was up to 95.8%, is almost pure THC. Are such strains that you can extract it. And CBD up to 77% in extract from flowers. Cannabis cakes, these are, as you can see, up to 1% per gram cake THC, because this is used for children and they do even milder. Cannabis butter for these cakes, of course it's more concentrated, up to almost 7%, but then you prepare cakes, so it's lower. You can calculate how much to use butter. Tincture, up to 10% was, it's like ethanolic extract. And skin creams was up to about 3% THC, what appeared in Israel. And what is also important to know, because when you treat yourself, it's good to have, because some people use smoking. Why? For instance, in connection with multiple sclerosis, because this patient, one puff, and immediately he feels power of this medicine, immediately. If he uses it by different way, maybe eats this, he must wait half an hour. Yes, but after that it will be longer time. So I studied from the same plant, different buds, you know, different flowers from different parts, and it's not the same. As you see, it was between 18 and 20%. In another, it was between 17 and almost 23%. So if they give to patients just only this one bud, and next time the same strain, so maybe it also happened that call one patient, oh, I use all the time the same strain, and I had such high, and I use the same strain. Probably they gave him butter which was more concentrated. So I checked 10 plants, and from each plant, five samples. And as you can see, it was between 16.6 and 25.7%. So it's difference if he has 16% or 25%. So that is why it's better to do homogeneous mixture. This analyze, and then he knows that he will use all the time the same. In Israel, they prepared for vaporization. Vaporizers, it's like a box of matches. It's small, and there are known amount of THC. And now it's connected with computer, and they just check it. Not yet have it patients, but in near future they will have it. So this computer, you can change the amount that when he inhale from that, so he can inhale more or less, that he can change it, and is connected to computer to physician. So physician directly can see how much he used, and if he is not sure patient how to change it, so physician can change it by computer very easily, even from long distance. And at the end, maybe I tell you something, how is important publish, how it can influence public meaning and meaning of politicians concerning treatment. You know, it started about at 1850. Research of cannabis was one publication. And as you can see, up to 1897, were a maximum 10 publications. Beginning of research, up to 1963, it was still less than 100 publications. And when was discovered in 1964 exact structure of tetrahydrocannabinol, so as you can see, it jumped up to almost 600, but it stayed about 300 publications a year. When we discovered anandamide, it was in 92, so up to 2013, from hundreds of publications, now it was almost 4,000 publications. And publications about anandamide, they are cited each year, so it increased up to about around 300 today. And publications about, not about anandamide, but about all endocannabinoids, as you can see, every year it's now around 700. So you can see that interest of scientists after discoveries of THC structure, after discoveries of endogenous compounds and receptors increased significantly because they were able to explain why is treated this of this disease, what was very important. So law should tolerate use of medicinal cannabis for treatment and punish exporters and importers of drug and dealers, because these dealers, they can be beaten very easily. And patient, you know, what is the problem? When it's illegal and patient knows that cannabis can treat him or her, so is ready to pay anything to the dealer. And they earn a lot of money. So this with decriminalization, it can be for patient much more easier, you know, and it can be much cheaper for them. So, and this I mentioned that it doesn't help to everybody, so it's good to identify also patients that cannabis doesn't help them. In Israel, it's about between 10% and 15% patients that it doesn't help them, but it doesn't help them, or they don't feel good after use. And this is another problem, because some patient, they use from start too high amount. You must start treatment with low amount. It's principle low and gradually go up. They start directly huge amount, and then they were depressed, you know, in panic. So they said, no, it's not treatment for me. And because it was because they didn't use it correctly. So it's also important to know. And if I won't mention my boss, Professor Meshulam, whatever THC does, anandamide does as well. And now many people ask if it was used as human medicine, anandamide. You know, we identified it in 1992, And after 22 years, it was not used. And if you look, I only two informations. You know, when in 1921, researchers discovered insulin, so next year it was already used as powerful medicine. When in 35 was discovered cortisone, next year it was already powerful medicine. We discovered anandamide 22 years ago, and it never was yet used. Because today it's very complicated. University cannot do this research. This can do only rich pharmaceutical companies. You know, and do you think that they are interested? They are interested to prepare from cannabis medicine, which will be expensive. They are not interested in treatment with cannabis. This is the problem. So, and I would like to mention two scientists, Dr. George Kunosh, is scientific director at NIAAA, National Institute of Alcohol, Abuse and Alcoholism, at National Institutes of Health in Bethesda. I had privilege to do research at his department at NIH twice. So, and he mentioned modulating endocannabinoid system activity may have therapeutic potential in almost all diseases affecting humans, including obesity, metabolic syndromes, and so on and so on. So that cannabis receptors, cannabinoid receptors are spread in whole body. So it can influence almost any disease. It's very important. So, and then I would like to mention at the end Schopenhauer. All major discoveries are initially ridiculed, then violently opposed. We are at stage violently opposed, but ultimately accepted as self-evident. Later, when it will be legal, so politicians will tell you, I told you that it's good medicine, you know. So, at the end of my lecture,